Good morning, friends. We are learning our subject data mining 3160714, and in that we are learning module 4, that is classification and prediction. In last lecture we have studied the ID3 algorithm and we have made the decision tree. How we have made that? That was based on the information gain, isn't it? And based on that, we have created the decision tree. Fine. So let us proceed further. Now, ID3 algorithm, that is to make the decision tree, we have learned, right? Now, what do we say about tree construction and termination conditions? All the samples for a given node belong to the same class. There are no remaining attributes for further partitioning. Majority voting is employed for classifying the leaf. There are no samples left. If any of these three conditions are there, we can say we'll stop constructing trees further, right? So what do we say about the summary of ID3 algorithm? That way we can recall the algorithm. Fine. So what do we say about that? Calculate the entropy of every attribute A of the data set S. Partition or split the S into subsets using the attribute for which the resulting entropy after splitting is minimized, or equivalently, information gain is maximum. Make a decision tree node containing that attribute. Recurse on subsets using the remaining attributes. Computing information gain for continuous valued attribute. If you are having continuous valued, then what to do? Let attribute A be a continuous valued attribute. Continuous valued, that means we typically used to say 5.5, 6, 7, 8, right? Something like that. Discrete attribute, we typically consider the full numbers, right? So what do we say here? Must determine the best split point for that attribute. Sort the value A in increasing order. Typically, the midpoint between each pair of adjacent values is considered as a possible split point. AI plus AI plus 1 divided by 2 is the midpoint between the values of AI and AI plus 1. The point with the minimum expected information requirement for A is selected as the split point for A. Split. What do we split? D1 is the set of tuples in D satisfying A is less than or equal to split point, and D2 is the set of tuples in D satisfying A is greater than split point. So with that we can split. Fine. D1 is the set of tuples which are having what? A is less than or equal to split point. And D2 is what? Where we are saying that A is greater than split point. Fine. So with that we can split. Fine. So what are the advantages of ID3 algorithm? Data may be overfitted or overclassified if a small sample is tested. Only one attribute at a time is tested for making a decision. It does not handle numeric attributes and missing values. Fine. Now, what do we say here is ID3 algorithm, right? Here we have particularly talked of the continuous valued attribute. Why we have done so? Because typically this algorithm works on the categorical data, right? So if say continuous valued are there, then what? See, typically in data mining, most of the algorithms typically are working with numeric values or otherwise categorical values, right? So before applying the algorithm to the data, we need to check it out. If the data is, say, continuous, and if your algorithm is only working for discrete attributes, then the first procedure which you have to do is convert the continuous data to discrete data, and then after we will apply that algorithm. Fine. So take care of that thing, and that is why typically here we have considered that computing information gain for the continuous valued attributes. Otherwise we should not have done that if it is working with all type of data. Fine. So before applying any algorithm of data mining to your particular data, take care what is there in the algorithm, for which particular type of data it works, right? It is nothing like that it is for discrete values, and if you are applying for continuous valued, it works. No, that is not so. So if your data is not the way algorithm requires, you have to convert that, right? So take care of that. So the disadvantage also we have seen. Fine. Let us proceed further. C4.5 algorithm. Now what is that? C4.5 is here. C4.5 algorithm is used to generate a decision tree developed by Rose Quinlan. C4.5 is an extension of Quinlan's earlier ID3 algorithm. So what do we say? That C4.5 is an extension of ID3 algorithm which we have just studied. Fine. So the decision trees generated by C4. Okay. What do we say? Now here, the attribute selection measure. What is that? See, attribute selection measure is a measure by which we select the attribute for splitting and making the decision tree. Fine. For tree-based algorithms, what do we say is attribute selection measure is the measure by which we select a particular attribute which will be used to split a tree. Fine. So in case of ID3 algorithm, what was that attribute selection measure? That was the information gain, right? Now what do we say about the C4.5 algorithm? It is the extension of ID3 algorithm. Fine. So what it is having? Let us see. Information gain measure is biased towards attributes with a large number of values. C4.5, a successor of ID3, uses gain ratio to overcome the problem, that is normalization to the information gain. So the disadvantages of ID3 algorithm, that is the information gain measure, is overcome by using this split info. Now what is that? That is split info of D based on A attribute, that is equal to negative sigma dj upon D mod of them, right? Mod of dj upon mod of D multiply by log base 2 mod dj upon mod D. Fine. So this is the equation for split info. Now what do we say about the gain ratio? This C4.5 algorithm is using the attribute selection measure, that is gain ratio. What was there in ID3? That was information gain. Here we are using gain ratio. As we know that ID3 algorithm was the base algorithm and C4.5 is the successor or extension of that algorithm. So this algorithm in turn uses the gain, that was information gain, right? So we see gain ratio of A is equal to gain of A divided by split info of A, right? As for example, we can say split info of income of D, that is equal to what we have seen in the example, the same thing we are taking here, right? This is what we can say DJ upon D, right? Mode of it. So we are applying that over here and what we are getting is gain ratio is equal to, what do we say, information gain, that was 0.029, divided by what is split info we have just found, that is 1.557. And so we are getting the gain ratio as 0.019. Fine. The attribute with the maximum gain is selected as the splitting attribute. It is having the same concept as that of the ID3 information gain. What do I mean to say is, in ID3 algorithm also we are considering the maximum information gain, and here also what do we do is we are using the maximum gain ratio, which is the selection attribute for splitting the attribute. Fine. So what do we say is, for ID3 and C4.5, whatever is selection measure, that is we have to select the maximum value of it for splitting attribute. Okay. What are the disadvantages of C4.5 algorithm? C4.5 algorithm constructs empty branches with zero values. Overfitting happens when algorithm model picks up data with uncommon characteristics, especially when data is noisy. Next, decision tree based algorithm is Gini index? No, the algorithm is CART and it uses the selection measure, that is Gini index, right? Some people are speaking it as Gini index, right? No, but we'll say it as Gini index. If a data set D contains examples from n classes, Gini index is defined as Gini of D, that is equal to 1 minus sigma j is equal to 1 to n pj square, where pj is the relative frequency of class j in t. If a data set D is split on A into two subsets, D1 and D2, the Gini index is defined as Gini D of A, that is equal to mod D1 upon mod D, Gini of D1 plus mod D2 upon mod D into Gini of D2. So, reduction in impurity is delta Gini of A, and that is equal to Gini of D minus Gini of D based on A, right? The attribute provides the smallest Gini D for largest reduction in impurity is chosen to split the node. That means what? See, in case of ID3, in case of C4.5, attribute selection measure was information gain and gain ratio. For them to split attribute in the decision tree, the attribute selection measures maximum value was selected. Here the attribute provides smallest Gini, right? What do we say is smallest Gini value is selected to split the attribute. Okay, so that is the difference for this Gini index algorithm, right? It is not Gini index algorithm. Based on Gini index, whatever is the algorithm is the CART algorithm, right? So we have studied three decision tree algorithms. One is ID3. Its successor is C4.5. And the third algorithm which we have studied is CART, right? First algorithm, ID3, uses information gain. Second, C4.5 algorithm uses what gain ratio. Third decision tree algorithm is CART, which uses Gini index. For ID3 and C4.5, attribute selection measure information gain and gain ratio. For them, maximum value is selected as the splitting attribute. Whereas for CART, that is based on the Gini index, in this we can say we have to use the smallest Gini for splitting the attribute. Okay. So how to do the computation of Gini index? Say D has 9 tuples in bias computer is equal to yes and 5 in no. So how we can find that? That is the Gini of D whole data set. How we can find that? That is using 1 minus 9 by 14 whole square minus 5 by 14 whole square. How did it come? See, we know that the equation for Gini is 1 minus pj square. So whatever are the probabilities for, say, here we are having two classes, yes and no. So 9 by 14 and 5 by 14, right? So 1 minus 9 by 14 square minus 5 by 14 square. And that comes out to be 0.459. Okay? Suppose the attribute income partitions D into 10 in D as low, medium and 4 in D2. So what will we do? For that, we can say guinea of income belongs to low comma medium of D, that is equal to 10 by 14 guinea of D1 plus 4 by 14 guinea of D2, right? And that will comes out to be, you can say this guinea of D1, this D1 is also having two parts, that is you can say low and medium, right? So for that we'll consider 7 by 10, 3 by 10, right? Here also we'll be having two parts, say 2 by 4 and 2 by 4. That means two attributes are say having low income, two attributes are having say medium income, right? For each and everything, for each and everything, what we have to consider is this 10 by 14, whatever are the attributes, see, the attribute is partitioned into 10 and 4, that is for low and medium. So that we have considered, right? Now for that also, whatever are two parts, that is say positive and negative, like bias computer is equal to yes and bias computer is equal to no, right? So for this D1, where we say it is low, for D2, we say it is medium, for them, whatever is the positive and negative, that we need to consider here, right? As the bias computer is equal to yes and bias computer is equal to no. These are the two classes for us, fine? So that we'll consider here, fine? And so we can say guinea of income belongs to I of D, and this is 0.443, okay? So if we are having say guinea low high, then what? Guinea medium high, then what? So we need to find the guinea index for them, and we can say whatever is the lowest guinea index for them, we will be having the splitting of attribute, right? Now here if we consider, this is 458, right? 0.458. This is 0.450. And what is the third one? It is 0.443, right? We have calculated that. So whatever is the lowest, that we will consider as the splitting attribute. Now, what do we say about computation of Gini index? All attributes are assumed continuous value. So do we need to do something for continuous value? No, because this algorithm works with continuous value. So no need to convert the values to discrete data, right? May need other tools, as for example, clustering, to get the possible split values. It can be modified for categorical attributes, fine? So what are the disadvantages of CART? It can split on only one attribute. Trees form may be unstable, right? So let us compare the attribute selection measures, what we have just studied. First one was information gain, second was gain ratio, and third one was Gini index. Fine. So first one is information gain. It is biased toward the multi-valued attributes. Gain ratio, it tends to prefer unbalanced splits in which one partition is much smaller than the others. For Gini index, what do we say? It is also biased toward the multi-valued attributes. It has difficulty when number of classes is large. it tends to favor tests that result in equal sized partitions and priority in both partitions. Fine. Other attribute selection measures too are there. Let's say they are CHAID. Chaid, people are speaking, but popular decision tree algorithm. We are not studying that, okay? But we should know, isn't it? So this is a popular decision tree algorithm measure based on chi-square test, or what we can say is independence, right? This you can consider as chi-square, right? We used to say people were speaking it as chai, right? The spelling you can say, right? So it is based on the chi-square test, and this D we can consider that is for the independence, right? You can say D is for independence, D is for dependence, right? And so we can see this algorithm, see the way we can remember, right? I'm saying you the way we can remember that is CHAI, chai or chi, whatever you speak, is you can say based on the chi square algorithm, and D for dependence. So it is test for the independence. Fine. Okay. Next attribute selection measure is CSEP. What it is? It is performs better than information gain and Gini index in certain cases. G statistic. It has a close approximation to chi square distribution. MDL. What is that? Minimal description length principle. The simplest solution is preferred. The best tree is the one that requires the fewest number of bits to both encode the tree, and second is encode the exceptions to the tree. Multivariate splits. What is that? That is partition based on multiple variable combinations. CART. That is finds multivariate splits based on a linear combination of attributes. Which attribute selection measure is the best? Most give good results. None is significantly superior than others. Fine. Now we want to know about overfitting and tree pruning. What are they, and how to overcome, right? This is what we want to know. Overfitting. The word itself says that we are trying to fit more than what is required, right? Okay, so or what is required, or otherwise we can say the space is small and we are trying to fit more than that, right? So that is the word meaning. Okay, now what here we say is an induced tree. Induced tree, which tree? Decision tree, right? May overfit the training data. We are fitting too much data in the decision tree. That is the training data. Okay. Too many branches. Some may reflect anomalies due to noise or outliers. Poor accuracy for uncertain samples. If we are having overfitted tree, too many branches are there, then it may reflect anomalies due to noise or outliers. It does have the poor accuracy for unseen samples. Overfitting is a modeling error which occurs when a function is too closely to fit a limited set of data points. Overfitting the model generally takes the form of making an overly complex model to explain idiosyncrasies in the data under study. Too much we have fitted. We have considered too much. Small thing we have considered. And that will be the overfitted tree. What do we say is, overfitting is a modeling error which occurs when a function is too closely fit to a limited set of data points, right? And overfitting the model generally takes the form of making an overly complex model, right? Overfitting occurs when a statistical model or machine learning algorithm captures the noise of data. Noise. Intuitively, overfitting occurs when the model or the algorithm fits the data too well. Too much. Bahut accha, bahut accha. Very good, we are trying to do. See, what we are saying is, the algorithm fits the data too well. Specifically, overfitting occurs if the model or algorithm shows low bias but high variance. Fine? How do you know if your data or if your tree is overfitting? See, consequently, you can detect overfitting by determining whether your model fits new data as well as it fits the data used to estimate the model. In statistics, we call this cross-validation, and it often involves partitioning your data, right? What you do is, how to know that whether your data is overfitting or not? That is by determining whether your model fits new data as well as it fits the data used to estimate the model, right? And this is called what is cross-validation. So what to do to avoid the overfitting? We do have two ways. One is pre-pruning and second is post-pruning. What are they? Pre-pruning, that means halt tree construction early. Do not split a node if this would result in the goodness measure falling below a threshold. See, halt tree construction. Pre-pruning, that means before considering a tree, that is before creating a tree, not exactly creating, but from creating more branches in the tree, right? We halt the construction. See, say till two level we have done, fine. Now for creating the third one, we are checking. What we are checking? That the goodness measure falling below a threshold. You have decided a particular threshold, and if it is going below that threshold, then you should not construct the tree further, right? So before constructing the whole tree, you are halting it, right, in between. So, but what's the problem in that? That is difficult to choose an appropriate threshold. Second way is the post-pruning. That is, remove branches from a fully grown tree. Get a sequence of progressively pruned trees. Remove branches. Fully grown trees are fine. It is overfitted. Fine. Now what to do is, remove the branches, cut it. Remove this one, fine, okay. Remove this one, fine, okay. Remove the third one, fine, okay. Right, something like this we are doing. So use a set of data different from the training data to decide which is the best prune tree. Fine. What we do is we are using different data set from the training data to decide which is the best prune tree. And it is why typically what is being said is whatever is the data set from that. Say 75% of data is being used to train the tree or train the algorithm, and we can say 25 to 30, 70 to 75% data for training. That way we can say 30 to 25% data is being used to test it, right? So what do we say is we use a set of data different from the training data. Whatever data you have used for training, not that, but we'll use the other data. You may have considered that data as the test data, so you can use that. That data is used to decide which is the best prune tree, right? So to avoid overfitting the tree, which tree? Decision tree. We are having two ways. One is pre-pruning, second is post-pruning, right? Before the complete construction of the tree, if we halt the tree construction, that is pre-pruning. After the fully grown tree, if we remove the branches, that is called the post-pruning, right? Now, enhancements to basic decision tree induction. First one is allow for continuous valued attributes. You can see Gini index based CART algorithm is already having the continuous valued attribute. So why are we writing it in general? See, in general mean to say that two algorithms which we have studied, that was ID3 and C4.5, in both the continuous valued was not there. So we have considered the third algorithm, that was the CART. But we can see in other two it was not there. So in general, when we are saying the enhancements to basic decision tree induction, in that the first one we said is allow for continuous valued attributes, right? Dynamically define new discrete valued attributes that partition the continuous attribute value into a discrete set of intervals. Handle the missing attribute values. That was also not available in the algorithms. So what do we say is assign the most common value of the attribute. This is what we have seen in the missing attribute in the pre-processing, right? In that we have seen how to deal with the missing attribute. We can consider the most common value of the attribute, isn't it? Or many other ways are there. You can try for that. Assign probability to each of the possible values, right? Whatever the possible values can be there, we can assign the probability, and based on the probability, wherever the maximum probability is there, we can choose it, fine? The third one is attribute construction. Create new attributes based on the existing ones that are sparsely represented, fine? So this reduces fragmentation, repetition, and replication. So what are the three ways to enhance the basic decision tree induction? One is allow for continuous valued attribute. Second one is handle missing attribute values. And the third one is attribute construction, right? So next one which we want to learn is Bayesian classification. what it is, and why should we use it? Let us check it out. A statistical classifier. We want to learn. So till now what we have learned, that was the decision tree classifier, right? ID3, C4.5 and CART. These were what? These were the decision tree classification algorithms, or otherwise we can say tree based classification algorithms. Fine. Now what we want to know is statistical classifier, that is the Bayesian classification. What it is there? Performs probabilistic prediction, that is predicts class membership probabilities. Whether a person will buy computer or not, it gives the prediction class membership. This is the condition, that is the condition. Now whether this person will buy computer or not, right? So that prediction is done through this Bayesian classification, which is statistical classifier, right? Okay. Foundation. The base of this algorithm is Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem we have studied, right? Okay. Where we have studied? You can say you may have studied it in your 11th, 12th and in your basic maths, that is in engineering. Fine. And if not, then it is fine. That is, I mean to say, if you do not remember, no issue. We'll see that. Okay. Performance. A simple Bayesian classifier, that is Navy Bayesian classifier, has comparable performance with decision tree and selected neural network classifiers. Neural network classifiers, will learn that. Okay, no worries. Fine. Incremental. Each training example can incrementally increase or decrease the probability that a hypothesis is correct. Prior knowledge can be combined with the observed data. What do we do here is, this algorithm is incremental. That means what? Each training example can incrementally increase or decrease the probability that the hypothesis is correct. Whatever hypothesis we are having in the starting of our problem, that is correct. For that, we will increase or decrease the probability. Fine. And prior knowledge can be combined with the observed data. Standard. What is that? Even when Bayesian methods are computationally intractable, they can provide a standard of optimal decision making against which other methods can be measured. Now, what is there in the Bayes' theorem? Let us recall that, or if you don't know, you can learn it. Total probability theorem. What is that? P of B, that is equal to sigma P of B based on AI into P of AI. This is the probability theorem. What is said for the Bayes theorem? It says P of H based on the condition X, that is equal to P of X upon H, that is based on H, right? Into P of H upon P of X. Now, how to remember? See, it's very easy, isn't it? Here, this is PH by X, right? That is equal to PX by H. Whatever is given here, the reverse of it. that is x by h, into what? Into whatever was given here, that is p of h divided by p of x. Very easily we can remember that, isn't it? So that is equal to, what do we say is p x by h multiply by p h, that is probability of h divided by p of x. What we have written here in the single line, we have written here. Fine. So let x be a data sample, that is evidence. Class label is unknown. Let h be the hypothesis, that x belongs to class C. Now what do we mean by that? Say in our example bias computer, we were having two classes, that bias computer is equal to yes and bias computer is equal to no. So here what we say is, if I say that p h by c1, then I can say that hypothesis is true based on the class c1, that is bias computer is equal to yes, and second will be say bias computer is equal to no, right? So p of h by c1 and p of h by c2. Fine. So classification is to determine p h by x, that is the posterior probability. It is posterior probability, the probability that the hypothesis holds given the observed data sample x. P of h, that is the prior probability, the initial probability x will buy computer regardless of age, income or any other conditions. P of x is the probability that data sample is observed, and P of x by h is likelihood, that is a probability of observing the sample x given that the hypothesis holds. That means given that x will buy computer, the probability that x is 31 to 40 age and medium income. Fine. So that's all for today. We know this is remaining, but fine. We'll see that in next class.